Главной проблемой, на самом деле, этого всего ресерча было то, что очень мало доступных данных связано с этой темой, особенно где есть лейбл, есть ли у человека депрессия или нет. Всего достаточно несколько, их всего лишь три. Мы получили доступ к одному из них, DiagWAS. Он состоит из 50 часов записанных интервью пациентов, клинических интервью, там 142 пациента в итоге участвовало в сборе данных. У каждой записи есть лейбл. Это значение от 0 до 24, которое соответствует степени тяжести депрессии, где 0 – это отсутствие депрессии, 24 – это клиническая депрессия. Также там присутствует бинарный скор 0 и 1, где 1 отвечает за то, что у человека есть депрессия, и 0, соответственно, ее нет. И мы использовали как раз-таки этот лейбл для бинарной классификации. Также стоит отметить то, что в данных отсутствует информация персонально о человеке, то есть ни имен, ни времени, ни там, где происходили действия, то есть никаких географических тоже фичей не было предоставлено в данных. И как я уже упомянула, из-за того, что данных очень мало, было решено использовать аугментацию, а именно к полученным сэмплам был добавлен белый шум. То есть это достаточно такой распространенный способ получения новых псевдоданных, и благодаря этому модель становится более устойчивой и не происходит переобучение модели. Собственно, на самом деле было проведено очень много исследований за последние 60 лет, связанных с тем, что есть корреляция между голосом человека и депрессией. То есть было замечено то, что голос больных обычно, депрессии обычно более медленный, монотонный, без каких-то экспрессий, эмоций, с паузами. И в итоге можно сказать, что действительно такие фичи, то есть как бы можно достать некие паттерны из речи, которые будут коррелировать с депрессией. В своей работе мы решили остановиться на мелких специальных коэффициентах. Это связано с тем, что, во-первых, их очень легко посчитать, заимплементить, они как бы несут в себе достаточно информации, чтобы как раз-таки выучить, чтобы модель выучила какие-то там паттерны, связанные с депрессией. Есть один недостаток у них, они, например, неустойчивы к шуму, но в нашей задаче это было не так важно, потому что условия, при которых были записаны все аудиозаписи, они были все одинаковые и достаточно хорошими. То есть влияние шума не было оказано, то есть, соответственно, на эти фичи не было оказано. И я ради примера здесь привела на изображение, как как раз-таки выглядят коэффициенты, чем они, например, отличаются визуально от привычного спектра. То есть я дальше об этом более подробно упомяну. То есть здесь мы увидим обычный спектр, где у нас по одной оси время и частота. А в случае, мы этот спектр преобразуем, используя так называемый Mel Filter Bank, и получаем, соответственно, уже другой спектр, где у нас подносит также время, но с другой оси это индексы как раз-таки наших коэффициентов. Обычно их там, в зависимости от задачи, можно посчитать 20, 30, 40, набор коэффициентов. Так, и как, собственно, мы получаем эти коэффициенты? Первым самым важным шагом, в принципе, в обработке звука это является разделение исходной аудиозаписи на фрагменты, фреймы. Обычно как бы duration, длина такого фрагмента составляет 20-25 миллисекунд с наложением друг на друга там, 10 миллисекунд. Достаточно такой распространенный способ. При таком подходе мы получаем фреймы, в котором сигнал не особо меняется внутри этого интервала, соответственно, можем спокойно посчитать фичи и использовать их. Далее, чтобы избежать краевых эффектов в начале и в конце наших аудиофреймов, мы используем специальную функцию Hamming, оконную функцию Хэмминга. По сути, мы умножаем наш каждый фрейм на функцию такого вида, и, по сути, сигнал как бы посередине сохраняется, а по краям мы немножко приглушаем, чтобы не было никаких лишних эффектов. И далее каждый полученный такой фрейм мы преобразуем с помощью быстрого преобразования Фурье, как раз-таки мы переводим в привычное нам спектральное представление, как было на предыдущем изображении. То есть как у нас была аудиодорожка, где у нас было время и амплитуда, теперь у нас есть время и частоты. И, соответственно, мы получаем энергию в соответствующее время и в соответствующую частоту. И вот дальше самый как раз-таки важный шаг, как мы получаем эти коэффициенты, и при чем здесь вообще ML, и как это вообще связано с человеком. Известно, что человеческое ухо воспринимает изменения энергии на высоких частотах хуже, чем на низких. То есть это изменение нелинейно, а точнее оно выглядит как такая логарифмическая функция, где у нас там до 1000 Гц плюс-минус линейно, а потом уже по логарифму меняется как раз-таки как изменение энергии. И, соответственно, на этом шаге мы также применяем к нашему спектру специальный фильтр банков, который переводит, по сути, там, логарифмирует наш спектр уже в ML-спектральное представление. То есть как раз-таки как бы человек воспринимал бы, как бы человеческое ухо воспринимало бы это изменение. Ну и последний шаг, чтобы получить уже, наконец, коэффициенты, мы применяем косвенное преобразование и уже как бы переводим уже в дискретное, то есть наше вот это вот спектральное представление в дискретное, а по сути просто получаем набор коэффициентов, которые нам необходимы и которые мы передаем, соответственно, уже в модель, на которых она обучается для каждого фрагмента времени. То есть изначально мы вот разделили нашу аудиозапись, разбили на окно, и для каждого этого окна мы получаем набор фичей. Теперь подход, который мы использовали в нашем исследовании. Мы решили использовать трансформер, который уже достаточно хорошо показал себя, там много исследований на тему, как он здорово все решает в NLP-задачах. Есть похожие задачи по распознаванию эмоций человека. Здесь также были проведены исследования, которые показали, что трансформер хорошо себя показал. И мы решили, что здесь тоже можно попробовать и сравнить это с бейзлайновыми подходами. Например, в качестве бейзлайнового подхода мы рассмотрели модель, созданную на свертках и на LSTM, на рекуррентные, то есть сети. И также второй подход мы решили построить сверточный граф, также добавив туда рекуррентность. В предложенном подходе мы использовали энкодер трансформера, там было 4 multi-head self-attention layer, и также было добавлено 2 параллельных сверточных слоя, которые могли бы также выучить какие-то там паттерны, связанные с пространством. Так сказать. И если обсудить результаты, то, собственно, в результате наших исследований действительно мы увидели то, что трансформеры показывают себя хорошо. Мы видим то, что в целом accuracy выше, чем у бейзлайновых подходов. Также нам интересно больше всего, наверное, метрика recall. Именно она показывает, какое количество пациентов с депрессией мы успели отловить. То есть на самом деле число не такое уж и большое, то есть всего лишь 39%. То есть представим, если у нас было 100 пациентов в выборке, у которых мы знаем, что есть депрессия, то мы бы смогли бы отловить только 39%, по сути. Это не очень хорошо, конечно, но это связано с тем, что, опять же, датасет был ограниченный, и конкретно пациентов с депрессией было в 2 или в 3 раза меньше, чем пациентов без депрессии. То есть как бы есть проблема с тем, что, в принципе, у нас очень мало таких пациентов в выборке. Также представлена confusion matrix, но еще интересно, на самом деле, сравнить наш подход с другими, потому что мы как бы не единственные этим темой занимаемся. Есть и другие исследования, связанные именно с детекцией депрессии по голосу. Собственно, одни ребята, они сделали BGRU. Собственно, вот мы видим, что они получили немножко больше, это третья строчка, то есть наш второй, у них это третья строчка, у них немножко выше аккуратность, выше немножко recall, но я считаю, что это не слишком значимо. И хотела бы еще отметить то, что у нас выше precision, это значит то, что мы лучше справляемся с таким кейсом, когда, например, у человека нет депрессии, и мы действительно говорим, что у него ее нет. То есть мы не делаем ошибок первого класса, когда мы говорим, что человек, у которого нет депрессии, есть депрессия. На самом деле, так как эта тема очень сложная в плане эстетической стороны, очень важно не совершать ошибок, причем с обоих сторон, что мы должны как бы и уметь хорошо детектировать людей, у которых депрессия, и также не ложно не предсказывать депрессию у людей, у которых ее нет. Поэтому в этом случае метрика precision тоже достаточно важная. И, собственно, последняя строчка, мы видим как бы абсолютно победителя по метрикам, то есть очень хороший recall, там, на 5 единиц выше, и accuracy, но у них на самом деле мультимодальная модель, и если в нашем случае мы использовали фичи только из голоса, то они использовали также фичи, считывали, по сути, фичи из лица, то есть как бы есть второй источник нахождения каких-то паттернов, и, соответственно, это приводит к улучшению метрик в этом исследовании. И на самом деле сейчас переходим мы к самой интересной части, мне кажется, моего доклада, это как раз-таки обсуждение предсказаний модели, то есть что, собственно, модель выучила. Перед вами как раз-таки есть те мелкие специальные коэффициенты, о которых я упомянула, как это читать. То есть у нас есть по одной оси время, по другой коэффициенты. Чем ярче как бы, участок, это значит, тем больше было энергии, тем, например, громче говорил спикер, тем больше у него было энтузиазма и так далее. Если же мы видим темные регионы, достаточно длинные, это значит, была тишина, пациент молчал. И как раз-таки перед вами типичная картина речи человека с депрессией. Мы видим то, что достаточно долгие паузы, практически отсутствует энергия на таких ярких частях фрейма. И как раз-таки обычно, ну и все модели, на самом деле, они смогли выучить вот такие вот паттерны, связанные с долгими паузами, и все модели, включая и трансформер, основанные на трансформере, успешно справляются с такими кейсами. Далее немножко интересный кейс. Это также пример речи человека с депрессией. Здесь уже паузы не такие длинные, они присутствуют. Речь, она все-таки остается монотонной, то есть мы не видим каких-то слишком контрастных участков. Да, мы видим, что человек нам, скорее всего, о чем-то рассказывал, но достаточно так, опять же, без энтузиазма. И вот здесь как раз-таки и на таких обычных примерах была проблема для бейзлайновых моделей, основанных там на свертках. Скорее всего, они выучивают какие-то фичи, например, когда у нас есть чередование небольшой паузы, потом как бы начинается речь, пауза, речь. То есть, по сути, такая немножко контрастная речь. Возможно, такие как бы контрастные полоски были выучены как паттерн какого-нибудь энтузиазма и... Собственно, здесь это стало проблемой для бейзлайновых подходов, но для intention здесь не было проблем. Обычно он справляется с такими проблемами хорошо. Скорее всего, связано с тем, что он получает достаточно информации о всем контексте и видит то, что речь на самом деле она не такая уж и с энтузиазмом, она все-таки более такая монотонная. Вот ради примера, как раз-таки пример человека, у которого нет депрессии. Мы вот как раз-таки видим большие участки с большим количеством энергии. То есть, если мы сравним с предыдущим, то что здесь энергии не так много, как уже у человека, у которого депрессия отсутствует. И, опять же, все практически модели могут выучить фичи, связанные с тем, что если у нас там есть большой участок с большим количеством энергии, практически отсутствуют паузы, то такие кейсы предсказываются достаточно тоже хорошо. И пример, опять же, ошибки, с которой не справилась ни одна из предложенных моделей. Как бы на самом деле на глаз тоже не видно, что здесь есть какие-то проблемы. То есть да, есть вначале какая-то пауза, вроде бы энергии достаточно, то есть как бы состав всего как бы, этого представления видно, что нет никаких там, опять же, пауз, понижений в энергии. То есть как бы весь эмоциональный, как бы, весь эмоциональный окрас такой речи, он плюс-минус одинаковый. И это связано с тем, что, скорее всего, точнее, не скорее всего, а есть такие кейсы, в которых речи недостаточно, точнее, не речи, а акустических фичей, которые мы достаем из речи, их недостаточно. Здесь, скорее всего, нужно уже смотреть на какие-то лингвистические фичи, то есть о чем человек говорил, какие слова употреблял, и пытаться доставать дополнительные паттерны уже из лингвистической части, составляющей речи, либо, например, уже, если бы, например, как сделали сделали коллеги, использовать фичи с лица. То есть, скорее всего, это тоже могло помочь решить проблему такого характера, когда по речи сложно сказать, что у человека есть депрессия. Соответственно, в результате в ходе нашей работы мы предложили модель, основанную на трансформере. Мы показали, что действительно обнаружили, что такой трансформер решает задачу предсказания депрессии по голосу лучше, чем бейзлайновые подходы. Мы протестировали это на датасете, доступном для ресерча. Сравнили с другими подходами, показав, что это действительно имеет быть. И в качестве предложенных вариантов возможных для улучшения нашей модели, как я уже сказала, можно использовать лингвистические фичи. То есть, например, да, нам, например, был предложен текст. Можно, конечно же, использовать текст, который написал пациент, но также можно, в принципе, использовать automatic speech recognition, то есть доставать из речи уже текст и использовать подходы там, где-то из NLP, чтобы создавать embedding по тексту и передавать это также в модель. Это один из подходов. Либо второй – использовать transfer learning. Мы можем обучить нашу модель, например, на похожей задаче, где доступно большее количество данных. Например, мы можем обучить нашу модель предсказывать по голосу эмоции. То есть такая эта задача, в принципе, более-менее хорошо решенная. Опять же, есть много данных, можно обучиться. И потом до fine-tuning, да, обучать нашу модель на, уже на наших данных. В целом такой подход тоже, скорее всего, принесет больше, лучшие метрики, чем обучение просто на данных людей с депрессией. В целом у меня все. Если у вас есть вопросы, с радостью хотела бы обсудить.
Евгения, большое спасибо за доклад. Сейчас обсудим вопросы. Важная информация. У нас здесь идет запись, и я попрошу, если возможно, и вопросы и следующих спикеров уже говорить по-английски, чтобы на будущее у нас осталась запись на английском. Я извиняюсь, Евгения, за такую мискоммуникацию. Вот. Okay, thank you for your talk. Does anyone have any questions?
Artificial data set. Maybe you can synthesize some data set in your problem.
Okay, I understand your question. Yes, I already said that we used augmentation. We add white noise to create pseudo-new samples. So it allows us to train more robust model. But as I understand, you are talking about synthesizing new samples like synthesizing speech. If we're talking about synthesis speech, unfortunately, I don't think, for example, male frequencies coefficients could help us because it's not good for synthesis. If we want to create real samples, more realistic samples, we need to use another features, I suppose. And it's actually a good way to create new samples, but it's harder, it's take a lot of computational costs and so on. For our research, we decided to simplify tasks as much as possible. So we use just common way to create new pseudo samples. It's agent noise. Did I answer your question?
Okay, we have time for one short question. If anyone wants to collide,
yeah, I have a short question. That you have, you said that your data set is pretty clean. That it, as I understand, was recorded on the same microphone in the similar environment. Have you try on the test to augment to see how robust your model to some, you know, because for other people that probably will use other microphone, maybe more noise and everything.
Yes, yes, sure. I totally understand your question. No, we didn't had an opportunity because we don't have any chance to test on another sample because we don't have another data set. Sure, we can add noise to our data set, but I think in this case our model deals will deals with such case fine too, because if we're going to add, for example, noise of restaurant, street or cafe, our model will train on it and after it will predict well. So the I'm saying that the condition in this case is still pretty same on the test, on the inference, okay, on the test. But unfortunately we can test our model in case of if I'm going to record my own voice, I have no label corresponded to this task. For example, I can test it like in ACR problem when I can detect my speech and convert to the text. I can use my own microphone and test in wild, like testing like in real world my model, but unfortunately now we don't have this opportunity.
Okay, Evgenia, once again thank you for your report. Mm-hmm. For so and we need to move on. I would like to invite the next speaker. It's Alexander Fishkov and together with Maxim Panov, they will present their work titled Scalable Computation of Prediction Intervals for Neural Networks with the Matrix Sketching. So Alexander, are you here?
Yes, hello. Thank you for the
Can you share your screen?
Oh, I'm sorry, yes, of course. Here.
Yeah, looks great. You have 20 minutes, so yeah, feel free.
Okay. This talk will deal with prediction intervals for modern neural network models. So we'll start with why do we need these prediction intervals? We propose to use them as a measure of uncertainty of the model. That means that we want to measure how confident the model is in its output on each new input. It can be implemented as an additional quantitative output. So in terms of regression tasks, there will be a predicted value and some value on the same scale indicating the uncertainty. Why do we even have uncertainty in machine learning? Well, the two obvious sources of uncertainty are the approximate nature of the methods that we use, meaning that we don't get the true value of parameters, or maybe even the model is not true at all. And also the data uncertainty, where sometimes you may have a noisy data set or just the noise is inherent to how you collect the data. And also Another more formal view on uncertainty is that classical machine learning methods usually learn to predict the conditional expectation of output given input, while we are interested in providing the full conditional distribution of output given input. And some applications of uncertainty in machine learning include reinforcement learning, active learning, also in terms of practical application is out of distribution detection and adversarial attacks, as well as some critical applications where human lives are at stake, for example. Next, we'll talk briefly about the definitions. So the prediction interval is just a confidence interval for the future outcome. So it's a random interval that is dependent on the data set, and in case of our prediction model, it is also dependent on the particular point where we want to predict the uncertainty. So it's the level of the interval corresponds to the probability of the future outcome being inside the interval. The basic setting in our work, we focus on the regression problem, and here we briefly state the classical model with normal and uncorrelated errors. So F is our neural network. Beta are the parameters of the neural network. X is our training. X and Y are our training data, and epsilon is a random noise with the fixed but unknown variance. Most commonly, this task is solved by minimizing the squared loss with L2 regularization. So here, lambda is our regularization parameter, and beta star corresponds to the true minimizer. But in our case of the approximate algorithm, we will get beta hat as our trained parameters, and now we would like to also compute the interval. It corresponds to the classical nonlinear regression formulation in statistics, and so there are methods like delta method that can provide such an interval, or you can derive it with similar arguments using Taylor expansion. We used the following formula from the literature. So the interval depends on the estimate of the noise variance, the gradient at the query point, and an estimate of the covariance matrix of the parameters. And that's actually the hardest part, because modern neural networks have tons of parameters. J here corresponds to Jacobian matrix calculated on a training set. So P is so-called effective number of parameters, and it depends on the estimate of the Hessian. So in all these computations, we don't require anything beside the gradients, but it's still very very complex for modern tasks. So what we can do? First, we conducted some initial experiments that showed that these methods applied to small networks and small data sets has shown good performance. But the direct application for bigger networks was infeasible. So in order to simplify the computation, we first used SVD decomposition to simplify the expression of the estimate of the covariance matrix, and this allows us to use approximate methods for the task. So for matrix J, it is almost always impossible to store it in memory because it is the size of the training set. And for this case, we propose to use a streaming approximation of the SVD. There are two related methods called frequent directions and robust frequent directions that are based on matrix sketching. What it means is that they accumulate some they store some smaller matrix and then read the rows of the input matrix one by one and update their approximation. So this allows us to save some space and apply it to our task. Also, we proposed the following modification. So since we're interested in matrix sigma, we should focus our attention to retaining the larger singular values of sigma as opposed to singular values of J. So for this, we propose to use the following score function to rank the singular values. It is just a reflection of this formula. So in this way, we can work with the rows of matrix J, but acquire the useful approximation for the matrix sigma. And on the next slide, I present the algorithm. Here is just the update procedure. So it works as follows. You read your data set, your training data set, one example after another, calculate the gradient, which is denoted Ji. And then if our buffer is full, we call actual SVD routine, and then zero out certain number of singular values and singular vectors depending on this core function that we introduced. So why do we have here two times the size K corresponds to the rank of the approximation that we want to use. So why do we keep 2K rows? This is done in order to limit the number of calls to SVD. So we exchange memory for speed here. And why this particular modification with the score is useful is presented here on this picture. So on x-axis, we have index of different singular or eigenvalue, and they are sorted in the descending order for matrix J. So for the small data set and problem, we have computed the true SVD decomposition and performed all other calculations. And then we also computed the inverse of sigma, and these computations are represented with dotted lines, and with the solid lines correspond to the specters of our approximations. We used the rank equal to 200, so here k will be equal to 200, and we see that if we have used the original method, then we would focus on the topmost singular values of J, so the leftmost part of the plot, and they will correspond to actually smaller values for sigma inverse. While using our approach, we focus on the largest singular values of sigma, and since this is what we care about, also it represents good situation, but still we miss something, so the method is approximate and has limitations. Now for our experiments, we wanted to compare our method with the exact application of the formulas. We have used the classical UCI regression datasets for this case, and we borrowed the experiment setup from the uncertainty estimation literature, especially I think the papers on dropout and other methods use this setup. So we have used the two-layer network with 50 neurons on each layer, leaky relu activations, and 20% of the data was for the test set. Everything was repeated 20 times with 20 different seeds. And what we care about in prediction intervals is actually the probability of coverage. So how it is measured on the test set, and basically tell us whether the level of the interval is satisfied. So other important metrics are correlation of the width of the interval with the actual error that the network made, and the width of the interval. Since we prefer narrower intervals, but still want the first two metrics also to be reasonable. And last but not the least is the time it took for computation, since we wanted to save resources. And here we see that even with applying the our approximation, we still get very good coverage for the intervals very close to the required 95%, and correlation of the width of the interval with the error is always positive, which is a good thing. And also the time savings are probably visible only on some data sets. I should probably talk more about it. So for CT scans data set, it is 50,000 examples. So that's why it requires a computational very huge the use of very huge matrices, and also the year data set is a 1 million example data set to predict the year of the song So that it also took tremendous time, and that's why the exact method is almost infeasible in modern networks. So next, I present the same metrics, but compared to the established uncertainty estimation methods for neural networks, we have used dropout and ensembles for both these methods work with the same network, and we try to do implement the training procedure as similar as possible, except when the authors in the corresponding papers propose some specific setup. So here we can see that unfortunately the popular dropout method fails to meet the required level of the confidence intervals, and what is more striking is that it even isn't always correlated. The size of the interval isn't always correlated with the actual error. Ensembles is also very good and on par with our method, but in real life it requires much more computational resources. So in our view, this is a good and promising result. The next important part is how to tune hyperparameters of our method. Essentially, the method has one single hyperparameter, is the rank of the approximation that we collect. And in our experiments, first, we should, of course, this setting it as high as possible is desirable, but resources may not allow that. Thankfully, if we record...
sorry, you have a couple of minutes left.
Yes. I see. So the first thing we measured the actual predicted performance in terms of probability of coverage. This is on the plot on the left, and we can see that even with a modest number of rows, the approximations provide valid intervals. But the unfortunate thing is that we grossly underestimate the actual number of effective parameters. Since it's only theoretical interest, it's maybe the practical performance is more important. So to sum up, we recommend to set it as high as your resources allow. And conclusion, so we demonstrate that we achieve comparable performance to existing methods. We can also apply to any pre-trained network. We do not suggest any specific training procedure, and we have a single hyperparameter. The downside is, of course, we want to scale even more. And future work may include extensions to classification, especially because we only can apply to logits and one versus rest setting. And I'm sorry, I'm short on time. I think I stop here and answer questions.
Alexander, thank you. Thank you for your talk. Does something. Okay, like in order to not set you without question, I have a small question. So the problem with all these inverse methods is that you will have eventually a matrix of size of the training set? And have you tried the simplest approach to make it batch-wise? And whether will it work or not? Do you get the question?
Unfortunately, not fully. You mean so?
Well, instead of the full training set, just take a batch and perform all the necessary prediction intervals and stuff for it, or maybe use some anchor points or some other methods. Just in order to reduce the set for this intervals estimation.
I see. Thank you. It's a good idea. So we didn't try it, but what we use is essentially is very similar. So we also maintain a sort of batch of size k, but we do a little more work and we scan through the full training set in order to select the most useful examples. So in some sense it is aiming for the same thing, to just extract some anchor points, although I should know that there is no clear correspondence between the actual singular vectors and the rows that produce them. But yeah, it's I think it's in a sense similar.
Okay. Thank you for your answer. So I think we should move on. So Alexander, thank you for your talk once again. And the next talk we'll be listening to is the talk by Ekaterina Kasatkina and Diana Babilova. Is there anyone from? Oh, so yes. Both of you are here, according to the Zoom. Yeah, I see. Can you please share the screen? So their talk. Of a multifunctional service center. So, Ekaterina, Diana, you have 20 minutes and 5 minutes for questions. So, please start at your leisure.
Thank you. Good day, dear participants of conference. My name is Diana Vavilova. I'm a postgraduate of Kalashnikov-Ijevsk State Technical University.
Sorry, Diana, sorry for to interrupt you. Can you please make your presentation full screen? So we are recording it and it would be much more profitable for listeners.
Yes.
Yeah, great. We see it now.
My name is Diana Vavilova. I'm a postgraduate student of Kalashnikov-Ijevsk Technical University. I and Associate Professor Ekaterina Kasatkina present to your attention the results of application of data analysis methods for optimizing the multifunctioning service center operation. The problem of digitalization is actual in Russian Federation, both for automated collection, storage and processing of information, and for the development of new digital management models and service for the population. Currently, the multifunctional center for the provision of state and municipal services to citizen, abbreviation MFC, is one of the main elements of digital transformation in the country. The quality and timeliness of MFC service provisional to population are important criteria for assessing the digitalization level. In addition, the relevance of the study of MFC work optimization is explained by their insufficient bandwidth for reservation through remote services. The regional portal of state and municipal service and the central services center. There is a problem of accessibility to state and municipal services through the MFC, which requires a solution. The purpose of this research is analyzing the MFC operation data to optimize its functioning. The general analysis methodology to optimize the MFCs you see at slide 2. Then analyzing data of on the survival volatility, FMR analysis and XYZ analysis are mostly carried out. They allow us to group and classify surveys depending on the stability of demand. As the MFR analysis results of all MFC surveys are divided into three categories, F, M, and R. XYZ analysis allows us to predict change in surveys needs with a specific time frame. It's based on a coefficient of variation evolution. According to the variation coefficient, all surveys are divided into three categories. Category X is a stable demand for the surveys, minor fluctuation, and higher forecast accuracy. Category Y is known trends in determining the surveys need, seasonal fluctuation, and average predictive capabilities. Category Z is a irregular surveys demand. Trends are not available, low forecasting accuracy. In practice, organizations use a joint FMR and XYZ classification to optimize their work. The research analyzes the operation of one of MFC in the Udmurt Republic, located in the Первомайский district of Ижевск City. The MFC operation data initial analysis includes the analysis of surveys by request frequency. Analysis of the MFC data in Первомайский district showed that 80% of 178 services provided are top 8 basic services. See figure 1. Further analysis of MFC work data assumes the classification of services dependent on the services consumption pattern, XYZ analysis. The MFC services in Первомайский district of the Удмурт Republic included in X category are presented in table 1. It's necessary to bring the stability of its receipt and and constant availability of specialists provided for this service at the MFC. Client demand for this service is well predicted. Next, figure 2 show us an example of service forecast from the X group using a trend power law model. Service figure 3 present an example of the service forecast from the Y group using a multiplicative trend and seasonality model. The Z services group with high demand is characterized with low predictability. This category includes only one service. Seasonal autoregressive integrative moving average models are used to predict Z service. See figure 4. The use of various forecasting methods to assess the need of MFC services help to obtain an accurate summary forecast for all MFC services in a short term. It is shown in figure 5. Figure 5 displays that the dynamics of demand indicator for all MFC services is well described by the combined model with account taking of seasonality and trend. Average relative approximation error is 8.5%. It can also be seen that in a period of April and May 2020, there is a sharp decline in the MFC services received, which is associated with COVID pandemic. So the MFC's operation optimization. The MFC operation with Telon received remotely can be considered as a multiple queue system with a limited electronic queue. The MQS properties of MFC is the input It's input services of a Poisson flow of MFC services request with a distribution parameter. The N, a number of services channels or windows which can be registered via remote services. Each window can serve only one talent at a time. If there are not three talents of the current date, then the talent is a queued electronic entry. The number of places in electronic UM is limited and determined from the number of services windows N and MFC operating mode. Then optimizing the MFC work, the following restriction they are taking into account. The maximum wait time in electronic U is up to 7 calendar days. The minimum window workload should be 90%. The results of solving the optimization problem for MFC of Первомайский district in Удмуртской Republic are as follows. You see at slide 5. The average talent servicing time is calculated as a weighted average standard time of MFC service provision and is equal 24.7 minutes. With the average service time and MFC operation mode by weekdays, the talent service average intensity by one window per day was calculated 16.2 talents a day. As a result of optimization, it's possible to construct an optimal weekly plan for talents provision for the main MFC services in Первомайский district. So we have developed a toolkit for analyzing and optimizing the MFC work. It simulates the MFC operating using the queuing theory. This model assumes that the MFC is multi-channel services center with a limited queue. Using a mathematical model, the service window optimal number is determined with a breakdown into various registration forms. Preliminary registration for the current day, and with a breakdown into service types. By using the MR analysis, we found that top 8 services account for more than 80% of MFC requests in the MISP district. And in the process of modeling the multi-channel queuing system, it is optimized. It was found that in order to keep the workload of Windows service talents from regional portal of state and municipal services and central service center at the level of not less than 90% and the registration possibility for no more than a week. It's necessary to allocate 11 windows out of 16 for servicing talents received through the preliminary registration forward by week. And so in the course of recommendation implementing for optimized MFC work, it was possible to increase the employer efficiently up to 96%, raise the number of talent by 30%, reduce the electronic queue as whereby improve the remote registration availability by 22%, as well as reduce the electronic queue wait time up to 7 days. Thank you for your attention.
Diana. Thank you for your talk, for your timely talk. So you took like half the time, and that's I as a chair, I fully appreciate it because we have some time like here. So does any of the online participants have the questions to Diana? Okay, so we have an offline question here.
Okay. You mentioned that the probability of denial is like 1 million, right? In your
Don't share.
Okay. So on the side with the final numbers, can you return to the slide with numbers? One more. Yeah, here.
No. Okay. Next one.
Numbers.
Exactly. The probability of denial is 8 and like 1 million. So my question, you have like 1 million visitors in this MFT. So how did you estimate this number with this precision? It's like PF, it's on the left at the bottom.
I did not understand your question. Maybe.
This probability of the denial is a PF 8 times 1 to the power of minus 6, 10 to the power of minus 6. So how did this probability was estimated?
This probability is theoretically from books. Books of multi-queue system. It's estimated early from researchers.
Okay. Thank you. So if there are no further questions, I would suggest that we will, in a minute, we will move to the next speaker, who is like standing right here. We have some technical stuff to do. Just a second. Diana, thank you for your talk once again. You can stop sharing screen now. Okay, we have an improvised offline speaker now. So just a second, we will share the screen and open all the stuff. Just a second. Can you see the report? I couldn't check it, obviously, offline, unfortunately. So, file. Go.
View.
Yeah. And your full screen.
Short slideshow.
Okay, so we have the next report from the people from the Skoltek. So Kirill Fidian will talk about the dropout, which improves the uncertainty estimation via diversity sampling. Kirill, you have 12 minutes and 3 minutes for the questions.
Okay, hello everybody. Hope the conference going well. As Evgeny said, I'm Kirill Fidian. I'll present our work and tell a little bit about uncertainty estimation in general. We present our work, how did we improve with some diversity sampling. We made this work together with Evgeny Tsimbalov, Maxim Panov. So first, what is uncertainty estimation? Machine learning models usually give you some predictions, and sometimes it's useful that you have also estimate the error for this prediction. For example, on the right we have example. We have some true function which is in blue, and we have four data points, and we can intuitively understand that where we have a lot of points, the error should be smaller, and in the regions where we don't have a lot of data points, we have bigger error. So the confidence interval would be wider. So ideally, the prediction which is in red should be inside the green bounds. And in this work, we'll work with regression task and classification task. So why it's all that important to estimate the uncertainty? First, it's misclassification detection and error prediction. For example, if you have a model that makes some medical diagnosis, and it says that you have a cancer, you would probably want to know how certain it is, because if it's 0.5, it's different if it's almost certainly sure. So another thing is outlier detection, because the real data is always noisy, and also some bad guys could try to attack you, and it's good to have the things that would detect such things, and you can reject to classify or reject to predict. And the last thing is sample efficient training and active learning. If the data labeling is expensive, for example, if you have drug discovery and to label each substance, you need to make some laboratory experiments, it would be nice if you have some weak model that would estimate the most potential things, samples that would improve the quality of your zone. So it's okay. Now let's talk about some popular models. Actually, the last year there was some big progress, but I'll talk the a little bit more classical approaches. The first one is Gaussian processes and Bayesian neural networks. They naturally turn the distribution, and if you have distribution, for example, Gaussian distribution, of course, it have some variance, and you can naturally use it as your uncertainty estimation and error. The problem is that it not always scale great, and also there are many works in this direction, but it's still not there. So some time ago, there was proposed that if you use the same dropout that you use for regularization, but on inference, in fact, it in some sense approximates the Bayesian networks. You can see the picture on the right. So you basically drop some neurons and you basically get many models, in this case, five models. And if you try to estimate the standard deviation between their prediction, then it's somehow relates to the variance. So if the variance low and all the five models return the same prediction, you can be more sure in your predictions. And then also was proposed why not to just train five models separately. It's actually worked better, but the downside that you need to train and keep like 5 or 10 models. Okay. So another problem with dropouts that you require quite a few of samples. In the original work, it was like thousands, but our practical estimations that like at least 100 forward paths you need. And it's usually not very practical to slow down your model one in 100 times. So we start to think what could we do? And we remember one thing. It's actually pretty known that the neurons in the models are often co-correlated, meaning that, for example, on the right is the correlation matrix. What it does meaning that we train some multi-layer network, and for one layer, we recorded on the all the values that we had on the validation data set, and then we measured how values on different neurons are related. And what we found that it's actually there are big chunks of the neurons that behave pretty much the same or very similar, right? We have these blocks. So what we decided that maybe we should try to generate dropout binary mask in some smart way that would improve the performance of dropout. For example, it would require less forward passes. So we use the so-called determinantal point processes. It allows to sample more diverse from your data set or in this case from neurons. It, for example, uses in web search. If, for example, you have a web query Jaguar, and of course the car company SEO marketing have a better SEO, and so they would make that all the search would be cars, but animals also could be the target of the search. So what sometimes people use, they use DPP that would try to make the results as diverse as possible. So how technically it works, that you have points, you have some kernel functions that is similarity between the different vectors, and you sample is proportional to the determinant of the correlation matrix that it's basically not correlation matrix, but the matrix based on this similarity kernel. So what we do, we pretty much replace the Bernoulli sampling in masks, which usually used for dropout, with some more smart sampling, which we done from the determinantal point processes. We also need to use different normalization, because in Bernoulli dropout, you basically have same probability for every neuron. And in our case, we have different probability based on the correlation matrix. So we use Horvitz-Thompson estimator. And it actually somehow works. For example, we estimate on the UCI datasets for regression. In these blocks, it's important the first and the third parts. It's like basic MC dropout and the DPP. And as we can see, first the higher the better. And another thing that in blue it's 10 forward passes and in green at 100 forward passes. And we see that our DPP-based sampling allow to converge much faster. It's basically enough 10 forward passes. And second, that the results is much more robust in the sense that it's don't vary this much. Okay, and the metric is log likelihood. Basically, it's a metric that force you to find the compromise between the prediction and the correct variance. So it's penalized for big variance, but it also penalizes if your prediction diverge from true value too much. Okay. Also, we try to make kind of out of distribution samples by splitting the regression data sets. Here we also get pretty big gain. And the last thing that we do, we apply to the computer vision classification tasks. It's MNIST, CIFAR, and even ImageNet. And here we try to make sure that the samples with high accuracy has low uncertainty estimation, and the DPP in our method in orange, it performs this much better. The only thing that the plots is not zero based, so I mean it's impressive, but probably we can made even better. But here it is. Do you have any questions?
Kirill, thank you for your talk.
Okay.
Please, if somebody online or offline have any questions to Kirill, ask them now. It appears that there are Dimitri?
Yeah, I would like to ask maybe one question concerning the slide where the approach was tested. I noticed that the data sets that were used for testing were mainly from image analysis. But is it possible to transfer the same models to other problems? Just curious.
The first thing that regression is what not image analysis. It you said that sets are just table data. The another thing that with our colleagues from NLP task, we try to apply to the similar approach to well NLP and they apply it to the BERT, and it's somehow works, not perfectly, but it allows some gain and improvement.
Oh, thank you. So it might be a point of further improvement. Maybe, I don't know. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
So it looks like we don't have any other questions for now. And then I would like to turn to the next speakers. So it's Dmitry Medvedev and Alexander Diakonov. Is like Dmitry or Alexander here?
Yes, I'm here. I'm sharing my screen.
Yeah, please share your presentation to us. Okay. So Dmitry will be talking about generating synthetic training data using gradient matching and implicit differentiation. So you should have 12 minutes, but we are more than on time, so please feel free start at your leisure.
Okay, so hello, my name is Dmitry Medvedev, and I would like to tell you about my article Learning to Generate Synthetic Training Data Using Gradient Matching and Implicit Differentiation. It was prepared with Alexander Diakonov. So data distillation general formulation is shown on this slide. So the aim is to train a student, which is denoted as theta. It's synthetic data produced by teacher, which parameters are lambda. Training the student theta star, we need to estimate the loss on real data, and then we would like to estimate it with different initializations of student. And minimizing this objective, we can get optimal teacher. So this task can be solved with gradient descent methods. So here we show how gradient would look like. So this gradient also called hypergradient, as teacher parameters are hyperparameters for student training problem. The goal of data distillation is that it can be used in practice, for example, for neural architecture search, when we need to train a lot of different neural architectures to choose the best one. If we could produce less data on which model train faster to the best quality on test data, then we could speed up neural architecture search. So the first approach was suggested by these authors, and it can be named as backpropagation through the student's learning process. The approach is based on the assumption that the student's learning procedure is differentiable. And this distillation methods has two problems, time and space consuming. To perform a single step of updating lambda, it's necessary to perform n student optimization steps. And while all intermediate results are kept in memory, I mean, trace of student weights. So another approach is to use implicit differentiation based on implicit function theorem. If there was an efficient way to invert this Hessian matrix, we would simply have used this equation after the student has reached a local minima on synthetic dataset. Authors of this approach also suggest to use a Newman approximation, taking the first few elements of Newman series and controlling convergence with hyperparameter alpha. So this approach has no problems with memory consumption, since there is no need to store copies of the students, but there's still problem that we need to wait until convergence to local minima. And so there's not a lot of steps of optimizing the teaching. The last recent idea is a usage of gradient matching, where the problem of distillation has been reformulated. And now the main difference is that we want not only to train the student to achieve a good performance on real data, but also to get such a solution as if it was trained on real data. So capital D denotes a distance function, Z denotes number of optimization steps, and next formula shows that a further reformulation allows us to minimize distance not between weights, but between gradients obtained on batches of synthetic and real data. The distance is cosine distance computed for each student's network layer. And the most interesting detail is that this approach allows us to minimize time we wait until do step for teacher optimization, as we update lambda after each step of student optimization. That's all. So also in our work, we try to use a generative teaching network. All previous methods for optimizing pixels of images, for example, for distilling classification image task data set. With this idea, we can optimize some generator, conditional generator network as teacher. And we show that it can help us to reach greater quality on test data set. Here you can note that we control the size of this generative teaching network with a hyperparameter. Here on this slide is the main result. So the main idea of our paper is to distill data using more effective methods as gradient matching and implicit function theorem, differentiation based on implicit function theorem with a generative teaching network. The main result of our paper is on the slide using gradient matching method and the correct size for the generator, we could obtain higher quality on the test data set. We used MNIST classification task as benchmark. The x-axis is images per class of synthetic data. It represents the volume of synthetic data set. And the y-axis shows the test accuracy achieved with data distilled with generators of different sizes, marked with different k, and also the previous approach where pixels of images were optimized. It marked as DDD. In our experiments, we think that it's fair to distill the data by all methods for the same limited time, as this should be counted in total time spent on neural architecture search. And we limit time with 15 minutes of training. And here you can see the in detail that increasing images per class, increasing volume of the resulting synthetic data set. Not all methods increase the resulting performance. It's due to they could not converge due to in these limits. So let's explain. The next slide shows more detailed results of distillation with different methods and teachers options. So unroll is a backpropagation through the student's learning process. DDD is direct pixel optimization. GTN with RND is generative teaching network with random input, and GTN with LRN is a generative teaching network with input is where input is learned as other parameters of this generator. The best performance obtained by proposed joint usage of gradient matching with GTN. Later, obtain with usage of generator, we obtain more contrast pictures. So, in conclusion, we can say that in our paper, we honestly compared the performance of all known methods, limited their running time. Also, we proposed new methods based on the joint usage of generators and memory efficient methods. And also experiments on NIST show that selecting correct size of the generator allows to achieve better performance for gradient matching distillation and improve the general visibility of distillation. So thank you for attention.
Thank you, Dmitry, for your talk. Does anyone have questions to Dmitry, online or offline? Well, I actually have a few questions. So distillation is a really like hot topic, especially in computer vision. And so the main maybe question is, of course, the scalability of these methods, because while you honestly, like according to the talk, compared the results with larger data sets or larger networks, because using VGG 11 as a teacher network is like not in par with the modern computer vision methods, which use like much larger models.
I think with more resources and with such efficient methods of distillation, we can try to scale on bigger data sets, and this probably would be the future work.
Okay, maybe one more question. So what matters more, two times larger neural network, like for example in terms of parameters, or two times larger teacher network, of course, and or two times larger data set? So are there any kind of estimates according to these quantities?
I think that if you want to increase your quality, then maybe two larger times data set is great, as two times larger neural network is also great. Here in our work, we would like to understand what is the most efficient way to speed up neural architecture search, for example, when we can train a lot of neural networks to some normal quality, not maybe the state-of-the-art quality, but we can try to understand which network is we are going to choose from all candidates.
Okay, I see, thank you. So this actually concludes our session. So if anyone have any questions to some authors, please feel free to join them in our Telegram chat, asking them questions or via email or some other means of communication. And there seems to be not much more than discussed, so I would like to thank all the participants, all the listeners, all the authors for applying to this section, for coming here and presenting their talks. Thank you. And please feel free to join other tracks for other interesting talks. Thank you.
Thank you. But if Dmitry is here, may I ask the last question?
Sorry, Dmitry.
If Dmitry is here only, I don't know.
It seems that I scared him.
Okay. So I wanted to ask about the developments, because the developments of that distillation for tabular data, because it was presented last year, as far as I remember, and it seems that the team decided to go to slightly a different path in that direction. But anyway, data distillation, even for tabular data, seems to be an interesting topic, which is not abandoned, I hope. But anyway, I will contact Dmitry then and ask him personally. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, please. Okay, I think we can then end this section. Or we can have a round table for half an hour if anyone wants to discuss something. Okay, it seems like there are a few volunteers to that. So then please feel free to join other tracks. Thank you.
Thank you, Evgeny, for sharing the track. thank you to all the participants. And thank all you, the offers.